Good morning, everybody. This way everybody will kind of get a little bit of a look. So I'm a walker and a mover. So I hope that doesn't make you dizzy as I go back and forth. Standing up on a podium, I always thought when I was 5'10", I wanted to be 6'3". This is as close as it gets. So I'll come down and move off of it anyways. First of all, it's an extreme honor to be here. I have been blessed to know a number of people in the crowd that I've seen in different venues that have become friends and really have been what I call messengers of what I'm going to talk to you about this morning. And I really appreciate you being here to hear about what's something that's very passionate to me, talking about your own mental health and how that we move towards this. So when we talk about taking the cape off, let me get my clicker here. I retired in 2021. And when I did, it was after 42 years, and it was one of the hardest things I ever had to do. And it made me reflect back on a number of things in my career and thinking about the cape. And I'll go through that and hopefully make an analogy that makes sense to you in terms of, do you see yourself that way? I do. I can look out right now and understand that you're here this time of the morning to listen to a lecture because you all also share that cape. And it's something to be very proud of, but it's something that also has some pitfalls to it too. So we're going to talk a little bit about that. I want to dedicate this to the best boss I ever had. In my last fire department, I was on Hinsdale for 26 and a half years, took 2 years off, thought I was done, went back to a fire department right next to me. I was from a career department, one station. I called it Mayberry in the best way because I knew everybody's wives, I knew their kids, and I had a great bunch of people. And then I went next door to the combination department because I wasn't done, and they asked me if I'd come give them 5 years. I ended up giving them 9 because I was just enjoying myself. And Alice was my last boss. She was about 5'2". She would walk into a room, and usually if it was a controversial subject, people would size her up and figure that this is going to be very easy. We're just going to run right over this little lady. And she would proceed then to tear them apart, always with that beautiful smile on her face. And at the end of it, I would walk out, and as we went down a hallway, I would say, "Alice, I think you just kicked their butt." And she would look right at me and she'd go, "You're damn right I did." Well, Alice was an attorney. She got her degree from the University of Notre Dame. When she started to have a family, she stopped doing that to raise 4 wonderful kids. She became a yoga instructor along with our village president. And in March, I got a phone call when I was down teaching a class that she had collapsed at one of her yoga classes, and she died the next day of a brain aneurysm. Only 62 years old with 4 kids that were looking forward to mom being there for their wedding. She taught me a lot about leadership, and she always had my back when I talked about this subject. So I promised her husband and her kids every single presentation I would do this year, I would have Alice over my shoulder. So I hope I don't let you down there, Alice. So now what I want you to do to start this off, just to kind of get us going in the morning, I want you to watch this film clip. Some of you may have seen it already, some may not, some may think you haven't and recognize it. I want you to watch what happens during the film clip. And I also want you to listen intently to what's going on. Because if I do this right, by the time I'm finished with this presentation, I'll be able to tie what does this film clip have to do with mental health. So Chris, if you wouldn't mind please starting it.
Thank you. telling you, I've seen some power before, but...
Thanks a lot, Chris. So what does a baseball movie have to do with mental health? So, and I really appreciate the introduction I got. Sometimes when you give somebody a bio, it absolutely reads like your mother wrote it. The only thing that's not in there was I got an A in my spelling bee when I was in second grade. None of which is pertinent to the topic that we're talking about. I'm just going to talk as an individual, who I am and what's important. Now, however, you may say, okay, if your third slide is a picture of yourself, aren't you maybe a little bit egotistical, and where are we going to go with this? So a lot of this discussion is going to be about symbolism. It's going to be about things that I hope you can relate to, things that I hope you can translate in your own life and go, okay, aha, I know what you're talking about. It may not be quite the same. So as I told you, I think when we come into this vocation, whether you're all volunteer, you're a combination, your career, your large career department, it doesn't matter to me. When I talk about you, I'm talking about you as people who have a vocation. And when you come into this profession and you accept that vocation, you raise that right hand and say, yes, I'm going to protect others. I believe the good Lord gives you a cape. And that cape is intended to protect you, because you are going to see things that nobody else wants to see. You are going to do things that nobody else can do. And therefore, you're going to need something to help you through that. And I think it's important. Now, for me, the cape was symbolized by my Class A uniform. Now, way before all that bling was on it, it was the first time I got sworn in dressed in that uniform. I felt like I was 6'3". I felt like I was a lot stronger. I felt like I was incredibly confident. I could do anything. And when I had to take that uniform off the last time as an active member, I cried, because it hurt so bad to take it off. Now, yeah, I get to put it back on as a retiree for, unfortunately, for sad things, or also for some pretty amazing good things. But it's not quite the same, because I know that I'm on inactive duty now. I can still respond to that. So we're going to talk about what your cape looks like. For me, it was the uniform. For you, it might be your bunker gear. It might be a stethoscope. It might be a sweatshirt, a t-shirt. It doesn't really matter. But everybody has something that you transition into a heroic persona. You become that cape wearer. Now, the shamrock's no clue. I'm standing up here with a green shirt and a green shamrock tie, if you can't see it. The shamrock's a huge part of my past. And on one particular day, one of the most important things in my life ever happened that was tied to the shamrock. So that's why they're up there. I tried for years in my state of Illinois to try and convince the legislature that St. Patrick's Day should be a national holiday. So I used to write letters to the governor. The only problem was the first two governors I wrote letters to all ended up in jail. So I'm not sure they ever got the letters. So it never really happened. But to me, that day and those symbols are really, really important. And hopefully I'll be able to tie that too as we're talking through it. So Paul Combs, a number of you in the fire service probably know, Paul is an incredibly talented illustrator. He sat in this class a number of years ago and he said, Pat, is this what you're talking about? And so if you take a look at the firefighter on the left side waiting before the tones are going to drop, before he or she is going to respond to the emergency, just your normal guy or gal in the community who cares. Then the tones drop and all of a sudden that captain, in that picture happens to be his rank, he gets the cape. And up comes the bravado, up comes the energy, up comes the strength to do incredibly difficult things. And that's all positive. So don't get my message wrong. That is all positive. The downfall, the negative part, is if you take a look on your right-hand side, that cape, where it's connected, is right up against his Adam's apple. Very much if I tied this tie too tight today, it can literally choke you. If you're not aware of what are the limitations of that cape, and the cape has limitations. And that's what we're going to try and center on during the next 45 minutes is, okay, how does that work, Pat? What are you talking about? How do we tie that to our own mental health? One of my friends gave this to me the first year I was fire chief, 1993. It was in my office when you opened the door in both firehouses right across, and I stared at it every morning when I came in, and it reminded me, what's it about today, Pat? It's about the mission. How do you carry out the mission? By taking care of your people. And who's last in that equation? I am. Well, here's the challenge for this morning. I want you to flip the equation, because I think that's how most of us operate. is it's always about everybody else. It's very rarely about us. And therein starts to be the first trap of the cape, is we're so busy taking care of everybody else that we never, ever, ever feel comfortable to go, hey, I might need a little help. Somebody in my organization might need a little help. Somebody in my family might need a little help, because it's seen as a sign of weakness instead of strength. The mission is always the why. Why do you do what you do? Why are you in this service? Why are you involved in community events? Why are you here today? It's always the why, and to have the courage to ask yourself each morning when you're brushing your teeth, what's the why today? And it may change four or five times during a 24-hour period. But we get locked in a lot of times because of our vocation, that the why is always about everybody else. So for the next 45 minutes, I want you to flip it. This is about you today. That's why you're here. There's no coincidence that you're here to listen to me this morning. You're going to take something out of here that I won't even maybe know. But you're supposed to be here. So just some quick questions I want you to think about in your own organization. Things that you do or are part of. Is the concept of mental health in the academies at the entry level? And here's what I want to tell you. In most of the places that I travel across the country, the answer to that is no. And when I'm talking about mental health in your academy, I'm not talking about teaching people how to respond to an EMS emergency that's mental health driven. I'm talking about their own mental health. Because when you recruit people, regardless of what state you're in, regardless of what the size of your organization is, regardless of where you are in the world, there is one character trait that we look for in every single person who comes into the fire service. And that's, we want people who care. Then we expose them to absolutely the worst stuff you can see or smell or hear. And we act shocked when it bothers them. It's going to happen. So what do we do to help protect them when they get into that scenario? We don't tell people that. My platform is, you should be telling people that when you do their orientation, before they even get in the academy. Now, I've had chiefs who've looked at me and gone, Pat, seriously, do you know how hard it is to get volunteers to join departments and then retain them? On the career side, we're seeing across the country the same issue of getting people who want to raise their right hand anymore. It's a phenomenon that I wish I could fix, but I don't understand some of it myself, but it's out there. So you want us to now tell them, as they're sitting here, if you were my group for the orientation and you're thinking about whether you want to join my organization, and I tell you that you're going to have vivid memories about things that you're never going to be able to forget. That's great. You think they're all going to be signing up at that point? They're going to be headed for the door. Here's why I tell you I think that's important. And they should have a family member or significant other with them, because as we know, your people are only as successful as the support they get at home. If you don't get that yet, you're going to find out real quickly when you're sitting by yourself. They need to decide before they get the cape that it's not for them. There's an instructor at an academy I went to visit one time, and when somebody was struggling in an evolution, we'd go, up, just another NFE, other NFE, go stand with the other NFEs. And finally, after 2 days of that, I went, what the hell is NFE? Said, not for everybody. Said, because it's not. We need to give them the chance in the orientation to go, this is not for me. Or a significant other to go, I can't sign up for that. I can't worry about you doing that. Because eventually, something bad's going to happen. And once you give them the cape, they will never give it back. And you have to take it from them, or something negative happens. So we should try and stop that before it happens. If I was your tax consultant, you'd all be in jail. I don't have that talent. I don't know how to do that. Not everybody can do what we do. Our recognitions of signs and symptoms, part of our company officer training. If I said to you right now, you know, right before I was going to go on the stage today, I came up these stairs and all of a sudden I got short of breath and I started to sweat. A little bit of chest pains, and I had pain running down my left arm and maybe a little bit my cheek. You would all think what? Heart attack, right? And how do you know that? Because you've all, even back to high school and whatever, been trained on signs and symptoms of what's a possible cardiac event. Now, I could just be that I ate too much sausage and gravy for breakfast and I'm getting old and I got indigestion. But it also could mean that I'm about to have an amazing event that may put me in heaven. And I don't want that amazing event at this point. Now, in your own fire station, somebody who's very, very involved, who's always somebody who's really very enthusiastic, comes to drill or comes to a meeting, or shows up for shift and they just sit down by themselves in a chair and they look out the window. And they're not on their phone, they're not watching TV, they're not engaged at all. And this happens again and again. Immediately somebody responded when I said my signs and symptoms, they were gonna do something about it. Do we do something about that person right away? And the answer is no. And the reason we don't is not because you don't care any more about that person than you did the person who was having cardiac symptoms. We don't do anything because we don't know what to do. What is that? Is that you had a fight with your significant other? Is that it that you had your son back the car into the garage door and you've got damage? Or is it because a firefighter was told his five-year-old daughter has brain cancer? What is that? And the only way you find out is to ask. So if you get nothing else out of this presentation this morning, here's how you ask and here's how you don't ask. So you ask the person, is there anything I can do for you? Now they may say, no, I'm good. It's not a big deal. Don't worry about it, whatever. And you don't need to push it. But you've now opened that line of communication that they know you notice something's wrong. You notice that they're struggling. And so somewhere it could be 2 hours later, 2 days later, 2 weeks later, they may go, hey, you know what? I need to talk to you for a second. So you open the conversation to them. Here's how you don't do it. No matter what language we speak across the universe, really, if you ask a firefighter, are you okay? The number one response for that man or woman is, I'm fine. I got it, chief. I got it. You know, I'm missing an arm and my ear fell off and I'm limping a little bit, but I got this. No problem. If I had a dollar for every time somebody inside a building said to me 5 more minutes, chief, and we got it, I would be rich and wouldn't be standing up here. We do that because that's the natural reaction. But what's the danger if you ask somebody, is there anything I can do for you? They might take you up on it. And then if you don't know what to do at that point, you don't know your resources, you haven't pre-thought it out, you're probably going to say, can we start all over again? Are you okay? Because I don't know what the hell to do with what you just told me. We don't think about that. And that goes into human pre-planning. All of you have been through drills, whether it's an actual drill or a tabletop or whatever, where you get the most impossible scenario. Your fire station is 4 blocks from a major railroad crossing. You have 3 people on duty, 24 hours. Everybody else coming from home. You get a call at 2 o'clock in the morning. There is a freight train versus a school bus. You are told on that freight train is every kind of horrific, hazardous materials known to man. You're also told on that school bus there are 40 orphans, but don't worry about it because there are 4 nuns on there that'll take care of them. Of course, all the nuns are blind. You have exactly 2 minutes to decide when you get to that scene because of the travel distance what you're going to do. And you know what we do? We do it. We make decisions. We triage the event in our brain. Why? Because we sit around and we tabletop every single disaster. Those of you who've been in this service for a long time know we've worked our way up from 9/11, from terrorism, to dealing with what we deal today with political unrest, with all sorts of things we would have never thought we'd do, and we plan for it. But we don't plan for that firefighter that came in and told you that his little girl has brain cancer. And we need to pre-plan that ahead of time. We need to know what we're going to do. We need to know what resources. You can't fix it. The Cape would tell you you could fix it, and I'm going to prove to you it can't. But you can't fix that problem, but you sure the hell can help. And you need to have already thought about what those resources are ahead of time. You don't want to be making it up during those moments because it's already hard enough to do. You're not going to be accurate if you try to do it by making it up. What are volunteer combination departments? How do they deal with this issue if they don't have an employee assistance program? I had a volunteer chief when I was traveling through my own state say to me, he goes, chief, worst call your guys go to? I said, loss of a child. I said, yeah, pretty much for us too. Your people live in town? No, I go, we're a very affluent community. I go, I don't live in town. Nobody does. We can't afford to. Gotta live within 5 miles. Okay. What happens after you lose this child? What do they do after a call? Well, come back to the firehouse. Yeah, do they talk about it? They might. Where would they talk about it? Well, maybe at the kitchen table or maybe on the apparatus floor on the tailboard. Is it possible they don't talk about it? I go, yeah, it is very possible, especially if we're coming close to shift change, everybody's leaving. He goes, okay. He said, here's how it works in the volunteer community. We have exactly the same reaction as your people do. except we come back to the station and there's no time for a coffee table and there's no time for tailboard because we have to go back to our regular jobs and we have to go back to our families. Except the difference is we go to the wake and we go to the funeral. And then we see that mom in the community and we are constantly reminded that the cape didn't work. And we failed because I didn't sign up to not make a difference. I signed up to make a difference, and that child is not alive, and there was nothing I could do about it. Now, I don't know what your EAP even stands for, Chief, but what do you want me to do about that? Yeah, a bucket of cold water over my head pretty quick. I said, I want you to start talking about, do you have chaplains in your community? Do you have people who can help? Do you have high school counselors that you could train about the culture of the fire service? Is there any, you need something in place? You need to look at that now because it's going to happen. It's probably already happening in your organization. You just don't know it. Or people have left without telling you why they really left. So put something in place. Do your human pre-planning, and that includes your EAP. If you're lucky enough to have an EAP, do they know anything about what your people do? And those of you who are parts of EAPs, if you're out here, I don't mean to make you mad, but I might make you mad by what I'm about to say. Most people in EAPs have not a clue what we do. They are tremendously trained to handle the normal human condition. They're not trained usually to handle what we do. And that training is out there and has been out there for years through the NFFF and other organizations. It's free for clinicians to be able to learn about our culture. But if they don't know, and here's an example, a young man who was in a class once told me, he said, yeah, in a 6-month period, think about this, was you. 6-month period, he responded to 2 SIDS deaths, and he had to put his dad, who was his hero, in a nursing home. Social drinker. Came home, started drinking every time after he was off duty. Never on duty, never drove anywhere, but sat in the garage and just drank. And his wife was like, whoa, something's wrong. You need to go for help. And he had the courage, which it takes, courage, that weakness, to go forward and go, I need help. They had an EAP, so he went. Well, he happened to be a young lady for this example. It could have been a guy. It doesn't really matter. He goes in, and the first thing he talks about is his dad and that feeling of guilt and pain, and I promised him I never would. And she helps him through the process. And he's like, you know, maybe I should have come sooner. All right, well, let me tell you about this first call. And he starts to explain about the sudden infant deaths and the mom screaming and the dad pounding on him. And he knew when he walked in that room and he looked in that crib that God had been holding that child for a few hours already. There was nothing that cape was going to do for him, nothing that was going to help him. And he worked that child anyways just because he couldn't just stand there. She got faint. All of a sudden, she got pale. He ran over to the sink, grabbed a rag, he wet it, he rolled over, put it behind her neck, talked her through it so she didn't pass out, and then he left. Now, what do you think he told everybody back at the firehouse the next day about the EAP? Well, you know, if you need continuing education hours in EMS, it's a good place to go because you can work somebody through who's about to pass out, and you might get some hours for that. But in terms of, did that help me? It didn't do anything. Now, was that her fault? No. She wasn't trained in that. She knew how to handle the first situation that's common, unfortunately, to all of us. The second one she'd never heard of. And she was that mom in that example. She was right there suffering her own crisis. We don't do that. So if you have an EAP, they work for you. You need to tell them that I want certain people to answer that phone when it's my people or their family members, somebody who knows what we do in our culture, and there's no excuse for not reaching out there to find out what your resources are. World War II veterans came home as an entire company by ship, and sometimes that took weeks. Vietnam veterans most of the time came home and could be home within 24 hours. Who has the higher incidence of PTSD? Vietnam, right. Why? Too quick, no self-help, no time to defuse, right? So these World War II veterans are coming back, and they didn't have any psychologist aboard. They didn't, if they had a chaplain, they're lucky they had one. And the only way that they were able to help each other was they talked to each other. They did really what was the beginning of peer support without knowing what it was. What are you going to tell your wife that you had to do? What are you going to tell your mom that you saw? Now, did that mean they didn't come back with any PTSD? Hell no. They had seen some awful and been experiencing some awful things, but their rate was lower than Vietnam veterans, because here's the example of the Vietnam veteran. It was in a newspaper, and I remember as a kid, my dad reading it to me. I thought I looked pretty spiffy in my Class A uniform. This was a Marine that was coming through Chicago O'Hare Airport, decked out in his dress uniform, which is about as cut as you can get. And he's walking through the airport, he's being spit on and he's being called a baby killer. And he has his little duffel bag with the last workout clothes he had when he got discharged. And he went into a bathroom at O'Hare Airport and he took off his dress uniform and he tried to flush it down the toilet. And he put on his gym shorts and he put on a t-shirt and he walked out through O'Hare Airport because he was ashamed. Now on Monday, he goes back to being a dad, a husband, a carpenter, electrician, a volunteer firefighter. No time to process, no time to transition. And the point of Grossman's study was to say, it is clinically proven, not Pat's opinion, not his opinion, clinically proven that if you talk about the stresses and the critical traumas you've been through to anybody, it doesn't have to be a psychologist, it could be your significant other, it could be another family member, it could be another firefighter, it could be a neighbor, anybody. If you talk about it, it absolutely helps to reduce the chances you're gonna have post-traumatic stress syndrome. Now, we all have post-traumatic stress. If I asked any of you to close your eyes right now and I want you to go to one place you never wanna go again, many of you, when you close your eyes, would have multiple memories pop in. The good news is you can put them back. The bad news is when you have PTSD is that you can't put them back. You don't have control of them over like that. They will all of a sudden trigger somewhere when you don't expect it and can actually ruin your life if you don't get that under control. I'm going to cover a couple of real quickly resources that I think are important. Somebody will say to me, okay, Chief, you talk about that if somebody's talking to you and they sound like that they're going to think about taking their lives, how do you ask them the question? And it's this simple. Are you thinking about killing yourself? It can't be sugarcoated. It's got to be direct. Because if you sugarcoat it, you're going to get a sugarcoated answer. And they said, oh my God, what if they say yes? What do I do? If you do nothing else, if you put this number, a 988, in your phone, so that you can literally stand there and call these people who are trained and hand the phone while you're right with that person and go, we need to do something right now. You have done an amazing action. Because again, the cape's not gonna fix it. It won't. But you can help this person by knowing there's a resource. And if you look at those numbers, I mean, since they put that line in and switched to the 988 helpline, I mean, the numbers have just incredibly jumped. 154,000. 585 more calls than they'd had before. Do we have a mental health problem in this country? Yeah, we do. And do we have one in the first responder community? Yeah, we do. And if you act like you don't, then you're just putting your head in the sand away from people who need it. I was at a presentation 2 months ago from the National Fallen Firefighters Association. It's kind of funny when you go to anymore to a class and you're retired, all the other chiefs look around and go, what the hell are you doing here? I'm like, hi, nice to see you too. Ian Bennett, who's in charge of this program, said, and I wasn't aware, he said, yeah, there's a new law that's out there that if you think somebody ends up taking their life as a result of the job or PTSD and is suffering from that, you can apply for the line of duty death benefits. Now, he was very honest and said, they haven't figured out the rules to that yet. What exactly is the criteria about getting or not? But he encouraged the audience. If you have somebody like that in your organization, you need to do it. Let them say no. You're trying to help the family. Whatever decision you made about the person, it doesn't matter. What matters is the people who are the survivors, and if they're entitled to that benefit, apply and let them figure it out. The important part is that there's some documentation that the person was trying to seek help. Whether you agree with that or not, that can be debatable, but that's part of what this law is. I didn't even know that was out there. Okay, so what is this program not intended to do? I gave you a couple of quick resources up there. I'm not going to give you a lot more resources. We could literally spend 8 hours on resources. When I started doing this program, a variation of it in 2009, if you Googled firemen's behavioral health, you got two or three answers. Now, if you did that, you'd get 14 or 16 pages. That's the good news. The bad news is, just like anything that we do in this industry, once somebody smells it as a vendor that there might be money, sometimes their motives are not really very pure. So your job is to vet whoever you bring in. Don't check the box that we are helping behavioral health for our people unless you know they really can. It's really, really important to be able to do that. So I'm going to, when I'm done now, I'm going to use cancer as a comparison. And I'll tell you why as I tell the story about making mental illness a comparable, and it is the same as any physical illness. And I'm going to get you to that before we leave. So we're doing good about cancer prevention. We are not doing as well on the mental health side. Now, when I do this talk, some of the material that I'm going to talk to you is very sensitive. So here are the rules of engagement of this presentation. They're probably a little different than other ones you've gone to. If I say something that triggers you, and that may happen, because there's a lot of experience in this room, so there's a lot of pain you've seen. If I say something that triggers you, whether you're sitting in the front row or you're sitting in the back row, get up and leave. You're not going to insult me. You're not going to hurt my feelings. It's not going to be a problem. If you get out there and you take a couple of breaths and you feel good enough to come back in, I would love for you to come back in. If you can't, don't. Because the thought of this process is not to harm anybody. It is to help you to understand the process a little bit better. Also, during this presentation, some of this stuff triggers me. And when it does, I can get emotional. So I don't need you to put on your cape and come save me. Because if you do, you won't hear another word I say after I have that moment or moments. I never know when it's going to happen or how much. I need you to just, I'll get it back together. I've been doing it long enough to do it. And then I need you to stay with me. So sometimes when I do this presentation, all of a sudden everybody's phone is the most important thing they have in their hand because they can't look at me. I can't hide from you. I'm up here under these bright lights. So don't hide from me. Keep your eyes on me because the only way I'm going to get through this is I need you. You're now my team. You're my company. And I need that help to get to where we need to go. Are we okay on that? On what we're going to do? Okay. So now, I told you that I retired back in 2021, January. And it's funny what happens. You know, you come to all these conferences and they give you nice goodie bags. When I went into my closet, here's what I found. I never saw this before. At least I didn't think I did. It's mine. I always had it. I put it on every morning when I went to work. I didn't realize I did. I put it on when I went to Little League games. I put it on when I took my wife out for a date. I always wore it. And I didn't realize it. And I didn't realize what it had done to me in other ways. Now, I'm very proud of this. Mine's pretty ripped at this point after all those years, but I'm very proud to wear it. But I will tell you that the hardest thing for me to learn was to take it off, that there were certain things I could not do that I thought I could because I used the same mode. And we're going to talk about that. So I'm going to now, I'm going to put it out here because I'm going to refer to it a number of times during this presentation. I'll try to put it out here so you guys can see it over there too. And I'm going to take it off. I'm going to put this down so I don't drop it while I'm doing it. Okay, so now I'm going to take you through my story because now I've got the cape off and I'm Pat now. I'm not a fire chief. I'm not even in the fire service. I'm just Pat. So told you shamrocks were an important part of my life. Both my mom and dad were born in Ireland. My dad sent away to school, actually got a diploma and came to the United States, worked as an engineer. My mom, second grade education. She worked on a farm. Both of them were sent to the United States to make money and send it back home to their families. They lived in the same town in Ireland. Only 15 miles long, never met each other there, met at a dance in Chicago, got married. Very strong Irish Catholic. So now Irish Catholic come along, what happens? I come along. Only child in an Irish Catholic family. I bet most of you think that's physically impossible, but well, I guess maybe they had me and were like, well, hell, that's enough. He's enough to keep us busy for 13. So I grew up very Irish Catholic family. In my living room, there were three pictures. There was a picture of the Pope. There was a picture of John F. Kennedy, and there was a picture of the original Mayor Daley. Yes, I'm in my 60s, so it goes all the way back to there. I was taught whenever I walked past those three pictures, I would genuflect and keep moving. To this day, I don't know what the hell I was genuflecting for, but if I said anything wrong about any of those three people, then I knew, this is my Irish alarm to make sure I'm on task, I knew I was in trouble. So I went through high school, I went through grammar school, I had a bad accident at the end of grammar school, I got hit by a car, I was crippled. They didn't think I was going to walk again. My dream was to be a professional sports player. I had two scholarships to go to high school, and now they told me I might not walk. 3 months later, after that happened, my dad passed away suddenly from stomach cancer. So now my dream of being a professional athlete was gone, as well as my dad, who I saw sitting in the stands overlooking me as a hero, he was gone too. And everything in my life now was black, pitch black. And so a week after my dad was buried, the bus that we took to the high school drove by there. At this point, it's a miracle that I'm in physical therapy walking on my own about a quarter of a mile. The bus stopped right by the cemetery and I got off the bus. And I walked from that spot about a mile and a half into the cemetery on a January day when the wind chill was in single digits. And I found my dad's grave because it was the only one not covered in snow, and I laid down on top of it. And I laid down to die. So when we talk about suicide, and we talk about that it's a selfish act, think about that. My mom just lost the love of her life. She's got a second grade education, and we've got a mortgage to pay. And the only reason for her to still want to be alive is this 14-year-old kid who she has watched go through all this pain and wonder if he'll ever walk again and be normal. And now he's decided he's going to take his life. I can tell you in that moment I was laying there, not once did I think about the pain it would cause my mom. Not once did I think about it was a selfish act. All I knew was I was in the most incredible pain I had ever been in, physically and emotionally, and I wanted to go through that door. And I had a strong faith. I believed my dad was somewhere else, and I knew he'd be pissed when I got there. But I didn't want to stay here anymore because there was nothing for me here. And then for the first time in my life, and thank God it was not the last, I heard a voice. And the voice said to me, "You need to get up and get out of there." And I thought, this is working. I am freezing to death. I had done my research. I was only 14, but I knew eventually I'm going to start to hallucinate and I'm going to go to sleep. And this isn't really going to be that bad. It's going to be better than what I'm in. And then I heard the voice again. Except this time when I heard the voice, it was very different from the first one. And it was a voice and a tone I recognized very well. It was a voice and a tone I heard when I disrespected my mother, when I got poor grades, when I was late for dinner. I said to get up and get out of there. And it was my dad's voice. And I looked over at that grave and I went, "Oh my God, you are someplace. I got to get out of here." So now this long fight to get into that cemetery was the fight to get out of there to live, because I didn't want to let him down. And I don't know how I got out of there, because my legs were frozen. They hurt like hell, but I made it out. No cell phones. Then I called on a payphone, and my godmother was the only one that drove in our family. And she came and picked me up and she goes, what happened? I said, I needed to get off and go see Dad. I never, to the day they both died, told them why I really got off that bus. Could that 14-year-old who lost his dad, who's lost every hope that he had, could he have used counseling? Oh, yeah. Yeah, I paid for that for a long time. Did I see his asking for help to be a weakness? 100%. I remember standing in line at that wake when everybody came through and told me I was now the man of the house. I didn't know how to be 14, let alone be the man of the house, but I took it. For the first time before I ever became a first responder, I knew what that cape meant. I put it on. I was going to protect my mom. I was going to do everything I could to do it. And it was a mistake because it couldn't protect me from the things I had already been through. But I didn't ask for any help. So now I go, I finish high school. I decide I'm going to be a teacher and a coach. I am walking now and back normal to that port, thank God. But my whole life is very different. And when you're a single Irish mom and you only have one son, what do you want that son to grow up to do? Be a priest, right? Well, I never got that memo, right? So I go through high school, I'm going to coach, I'm going to do everything. And then 2 years into my college, all of a sudden, that little voice again. Maybe you should think about why are you still here? And so I thought about the car accident where I should have been killed. I thought about I should have died in that cemetery. Maybe my vocation is really to the religious order. So I went in and I spent 2 years, finished up, graduated, and it was time to go on to the big seminary. And then I heard the little voice again. This time it said, "Are you sure that's what you want to do?" And I, "Well, will you make up your mind for crying out loud? Like, what do you mean? Are you sure this is what you want to do?" And it's like, all that adulation you were hoping to get in high school, you wanted to be the big star, have the cutest cheerleader, have your dad in the top, you didn't get any of that. But you got it in the seminary. You got told you were great. You would be a fantastic priest. Maybe you should think it through. So I took a year off, and I figured if it's really a vocation, I'll come back in and I'll go. And before I left, in fact, they put a bunch of papers in front of me and didn't say if you come back. They're like, when you come back, here's what you got to fill out. And I'm looking at it real quick. I'm not really paying much attention because I'm taking a year off. All of a sudden, I look at this one. I go, what's this celibacy thing? What? For how long? I'll say grace before meals. That's not going to happen. So I go on. I become a teacher and a coach. I get married. I meet a real Irish Catholic, Eileen, 13 brothers and sisters, right? So the first family event I went to where I said, who are your brothers and sisters, was like coming into this room and having Eileen point and go, all of them. 8 brothers, like, and she was the favorite sister. Couldn't, best thing ever happened to me. Got married, had 3 boys, Brendan, Patrick, and Sean. This is Sean, my youngest. Absolutely of the 3, the one I believed that was going to be the firefighter. A heart as big as his body, that smile, engaging to people, all sorts of courage. When Sean was 5, he was diagnosed with clinical depression. I didn't know you could have clinical depression at 5. I knew you could be sad and take away your ice cream and different things. But I didn't know you could have depression. My wife, the hero, the real 6 bugle, noticed it. He was coloring everything in black, and Velcro shoes were a big deal back then, and he would do it 50 times before he went to kindergarten, literally 50. Not 51, not 49, 50. If you interrupted that cycle, we got to go, he would have what I called an Irish temper tantrum. What I found out later was a panic attack. He went all the way through grammar school, seeking counseling, getting medication, all the while I went along with it because I wear this thing. We'll fix this. My kid's not sick. I mean, he'll grow out of this like anything else. Time we got to junior high, it just got worse. When you have mental health challenges, because mental health is a physical illness, it's a chemical change in your body. Just like you can't all of a sudden go, no, I'm going to wake up today and not have diabetes anymore. You can't do that either because it's physical. It's not a character deficiency. It's not a weakness, and it sure the hell isn't a choice. He got worse as he went through puberty. He got also obsessive compulsive disorder as a diagnosis, which is just hell on earth. And all through high school, we had multiple suicide attempts, right on the precipice of leaving this earth multiple times. And finally, by the time we got to the end of high school, we were drained. We were drained financially, we were drained emotionally, and we took him to Mayo Clinic. We took out a second mortgage on our home. And at Mayo Clinic, they tested him for an entire week. At the end of the week, they told us he's terminal. And I went, oh my God, you found something, right? How sad is that? You found something. You found something in his brain. You found something that's wrong. Like, no, you don't get it. We have 10 women who come in here who all have breast cancer, same age, same stage, give them the same treatment. 9 survive and flourish. 1 dies. And we don't know why. All we know is the disease didn't respond to the treatment. Sean has tried every single treatment known to man, and it's not working. And none of the medications are working. So if we don't find something pretty soon, he's going to go, because every day he wakes up and he doesn't, now always remember this, he doesn't wake up thinking about, I'm going to take my life today. He wakes up thinking, I'm going to stay one more day in this pain. Now you think about that as a dad. That's not what you want to hear. This thing's supposed to save everybody. Well, hell, I'm supposed to save my young, I'm supposed to save them, my baby. And I can't do anything. So we had to put him in a group home because I had a conversation nobody should have. I said, Sean, you can't have any more suicide attempts. I can't have mom find you. You got to promise me no more. And he said, with big tears in his eyes, I can't do that. If it gets bad enough, I just can't do that. So he went into a group home. About 2 months in there, he goes missing. We get a phone call. He's gone. I'm like, what do you mean he's gone? I said, well, it's not a lockdown facility, Pat. So we had a call the next morning from the local hospital. And this is a story I used to not tell as part of this, but there's at least one person out here today. You're supposed to hear this story. This one's for you, and maybe more than one. And so the local hospital calls. They said, we have your son. He's been down for a while. We don't know how long, but you need to get here right away. We rush to the hospital, get there, and he's on a ventilator. He's gray. He's ashen. He's aspirating around the tube. Oh, we've all seen it. He's gone. You go in, you sign the DNR papers. You go in and talk about organ donations and all things you shouldn't be thinking about, and it just seems surreal. And I remember whispering in his ear, I go, Sean, it's okay to go. Go. This body of yours is defective. You don't need this pain anymore. I'll take care of mom. I'll take care of you 2 brothers. You just need to go. And the next morning, the doctor came in and said, I want to tear up the DNR. I go, why would I do that? He said, because he's fighting. He's trying to come back. So we tried taking him off the vent. day two, day three, day four, day five. They said, if he doesn't come off the vent today, you'll have to find a place for him. So what does that mean? So you mean a place like he's going to lay there and just keep breathing on this tube and his mom go visit him every day until he doesn't breathe anymore? And they were like, he can't stay up here in intensive care. That fifth day was St. Patrick's Day, his favorite day. My boys all were very poor in math, but if we had a party at the house and we had a keg of green keg of beer on St. Patrick's Day, all three of my boys could pour a perfect beer with a perfect head. Sean probably got more tips than any kid at any of those parties. Love St. Patrick's Day. And I'm like, this isn't going to work. He's not going to come off that vent. He's going to die. So I stood in the hallway while they got ready to take him off. Mr. Tough Fire Chief, Mr. Cape Wearer, my wife, was the only one with the courage to be in that room because I knew he wasn't going to come off of it. And I'm thinking, where am I going to find a place for him? How am I going to mend her broken? How am I going to save my boys and her? And then all of a sudden I heard coughing in the room, and then I heard it again, and I thought it was a nurse. I looked in the room, and there he was with this big smile on his face. And he's looking right at me, and I'm like, oh my God, he's off the vent. And I had on this hideous St. Patrick's Day tie, and he smiles. I go, are you laughing at my tie? And he shook his head, and I went, oh my God, I got my kid back. I ran in there. Now, what I didn't realize when I ran in there was everybody in the room was crying. The nurses, the doctors, everybody, because nobody believed he was going to come off that day either. We got our miracle. And this is the part of the story you need to hear. The next day, he calls me on the phone with this raspy voice, are you coming to see me? I said, are you kidding me? We'll be there in 2 minutes. He proceeds to tell me as he looks at me and says, I saw Sean Kenny. I'm going, oh no, he's got brain damage. He doesn't even know who he is. My wife, as usual, said, Pat, just be quiet. No, Sean, you're Sean Kenny. I said, no, Sean looks just like Dad, but younger. Who looks just like Dad? He then went on to describe my dad in details that he had never seen. My dad, when he passed away, was middle 50s, very heavy set, lost most of his hair. He described my dad, who was a great athlete in Ireland, as this cut guy with these huge hands, black curly hair, stuff he had never seen. And he talked about how he talked to him on a concrete bench. When I was growing up, remember I told you nobody drove? My dad and I took the bus everywhere. Sean had never seen these concrete benches. They didn't exist anymore that day. And my wife said, did he talk to you? And he said, yeah. So what did he say? He said, tell Dad I'm sorry I had to leave him so early. Now, no 20-year-old kid who's even been through everything he is would know how a father would feel. And he had big tears in his eyes. And she said, did he say anything else? I said, yeah, Sean, you need to go back. Now, to me, my miracle had happened. I knew now my dad really did see what I had done all my life. He was really someplace else. And Sean was back. We had our second chance. It didn't work. He got worse. He had lost some of his hearing 2 months later in June 3rd of 2006. He died by suicide. Now, a lot of people say to me at the time, well, I bet you're really angry. Look what he did to his wife, your wife. Look what he did to your kids, whatever. Hell no. That kid fought one of the most courageous battles I had ever watched anybody fight. Amazing. And he taught me about mental health, what I'm going to share with you in the next couple of slides, that I never would have known if I had not watched him suffer. If I had not learned, this is baloney. This thing doesn't work at all. I shouldn't have even tried to rely on it. It was a mistake. I didn't even tell anybody in my organization how sick Sean was because I didn't want them to judge him. If I had shared it with my people, they would have had my back, my wife's back, my kids' back, and his back. But I didn't do it because I felt the stigma. I felt the shame. And now I'm like, Sean, you didn't die in vain. We're going to tell the story to people like you. We're going to carry it on so that we're living this dream out. Found this in his room. I couldn't go in his room for almost a year after he died. I found his room. You look at the last line, it says, when I grow up, I'm going to be a fireman. Yeah, well, he is a fireman now. He's stationed in heaven, not here on this earth. But he has saved more people since 2009 than I've met and impacted people who never met me and never met him because they've heard his name, they've read his story, they know who he is and what he did. And now we're going to go to the crux of what we need to do here. So compare cancer and mental health. My wife and I talked about, I've been doing this for a number of years. I could look at the audience and most of the audience would be shaking their heads like, I get it. It's a physical illness, but maybe 25% did not. They just felt bad for me, which I appreciated, but they weren't getting the message. So we said, let's compare it to a physical illness. And so we did. We decided to pick brain cancer. So when you look up there on the screen, what you see is, in both cases, cancer and mental health, we're exposed to stressful situations. We've done so much better and so much more progressive on cancer preventatively. Why? Because it's okay to talk about it. It doesn't make people uncomfortable. Mental health makes people uncomfortable because, again, they feel that stigma that it's some kind of a weakness. There's a possible predisposition for cancer. I've had more colonoscopies because my dad died of stomach cancer than anybody I know. Every nurse in the state of Illinois knows what my butt looks like, and it hasn't gotten better over the last 60 years, right? But it's probably saved my life, and it saved a number of other people's lives. The same thing happens on mental health. Are my grandkids possibly going to go down the road of having depression or anxiety? Maybe. That's not proven, but it's possible, so I have my antenna up. We deny the condition with cancer. It's like, yeah, it's just a cyst on my back. It's no big deal. It'll go away. Nobody needs to look at it, and sometimes we wait too long. And on the mental health side, everybody goes through stress. What are we going to do? It's what you do. No, you need to ask for help. The annual physical picks up cancer. The annual physical, we don't evaluate mental health if you do it. We don't. That poor kid I told you about with the two SIDS and his grandpa, didn't evaluate any of that. Nobody asked him. He needed help. Hope one day with the medication and cancer can lead to despair the next. How many times do you hear somebody pass away from cancer because of the treatment, not because of the disease? And it's the same thing on the mental health side. The number one side effect of Sean's medication was suicidal ideation. And I remember saying to the doctor, you're giving him something. Do you know why he's in this hospital, doc? And you're giving him something that's making him think about it more. Yeah. He said, because it works. But on some people, it makes them worse. The big difference is when you have a funeral. Somebody dies in the fire service because of cancer, they get a hero send-off, as they should. They didn't lose the battle. They decided they didn't want to deal with cancer anymore, and they went home. When somebody dies of suicide in the fire service, I'm still getting phone calls about the stigma associated with the people don't do anything about it. So what does terminal look like? That's Sean on the left. That's my wife, Eileen, on the right. She was diagnosed with brain cancer in 2016, 6 months after we put that slide in there. And I remember crying on the bed going, did I jinx you? Is this my fault? Why did I pick that disease? And I was told she would have 9 months to live. And that's how much she did. She died right before our son's wedding. And right before she died, she said to me, I'm not going to make the wedding. And she had fought like hell. I go, what do you mean? We just said you were going to make the wedding last night to the kids. She goes, I saw Sean. I go, what? She said, I saw Sean. I go, where did you see Sean? And she pointed to the end of the bed. I go, did he talk to you? She said, yeah, Patty looked so happy, and he was bright-eyed, like he was a little boy again. And he said, Mom, I'm coming to get you. So again, for all of those you, if you've lost somebody, I don't know where it is. I don't know what you call it. It has nothing to do with what your religious designation is, but there's a place for those people, and I believe that that's where they're at this point. I'm going to skip through this because we're getting to the end. Last thing here. So if you go back to your department and you have naysayers who go, hey, that's great that guy from Illinois got up there and told you it's a physical illness. No, it's not. It's a choice. I want you to compare it to a back injury. We bring people into the recruit academy and we tell them, come on in. Here's the proper way to lift so you don't injure your back. Well, that's great if you can lift in every call like that. It doesn't work like that. We all know that. Your first call might be a full arrest with somebody between the commode and the bathtub, and you got to yank them out as best you could to work them. What happens when we have a back injury? We tell them. Tell somebody right away. Why? Because we have to do the string of documentation. Okay, what happens then? We send them to a doctor who knows what firefighters do. Not just a regular doctor, but somebody who's vetted in what we do. The treatment might include medication, muscle relaxers, whatever. It might include therapy. But the goal is to bring them back 100% to their family as well as to your service. On the mental health side, it should be exactly the same. What we should do is we should tell somebody right away. We should then have the resources to send them to somebody who can help them, who knows what we do. They may end up on medication for a while. They may end up on medication for the rest of their life. But if it handles that chemical imbalance, who cares? And then therapy also, with the same goal. Bring them back 100% to their families and to the service. It's the same thing. It's that simple. We've just complicated it because of the stigma. So now, I'm going to bring you back, finish. What the hell did that movie have to do with this? I watched that movie at least 100 times. My wife died in November. On Christmas that year, I could hardly keep my head up. I didn't want to hear anything. I didn't want anything positive. And I'm flipping through the channels, and The Natural comes on. I go, well, this is a no-brainer movie. It's mindless. I'm just going to let it run. And then that scene came on. Now, I never noticed ever in that scene how angry that crowd was. They all had a crowd mentality. Right? All yelling, you loser, everything. The same thing we believed as a group, as an organization about mental health. It's a weakness. It's a character deficiency. We put the stigma on it. And then one person has the guts to stand up against that crowd. And I never noticed when she stood up, she was dressed in all white. I never noticed that there was a glow behind her, never. And what happens? He gets out of the batter's box. He doesn't even know what's going on. He's failing. He knows. He looks around. He's like, you can see him processing. He gets back in with a much more determined look. And he hits a home run. And he smashes the clock. Yeah, like Hollywood. And all of a sudden, I sat on the couch and I went, smash the clock. Smash the stigma. Oh, my God. My wife used to stand in that back corner right there by the exit every time I did this presentation. And when I would start to cry, she would just nod at me. And she said, the nod means Sean is right behind you. That woman was an angel with that glow behind her. She gave him his, at the end of the movie, he said, why'd you stand up that day? She said, because I didn't want to see you fail. That's what we have the responsibility to do. We need to do like my wife did, like she did in the movie. We need to stand up for people who are struggling with mental illness. And we need to put the cape back on to do that. That's our mission then, to help those people. So that they don't feel like they fail, because they're not a failure, they have an illness. And we had every responsibility that we need to do something for them. And you all care, or you wouldn't be sitting here right now. So you can do this, you can become part of Sean and Eileen's disciples. And I'm gonna go right through here real quick to the end. So that's what I think heaven looks like now. I got two healthy people up there. I wear that S now for them. I wear that S for Sean, and I wear that S for Eileen. She's my someone. And that's how I carry out this message. She loved to stand on a balcony and overlook the ocean. I'd never been here before. I went out there last night and couldn't believe it. And I stood on that balcony and I felt her standing there. And she said, you make sure you get that message across tomorrow morning. Don't mess it up. Got it. All right. So last thing I promised her was, she told me right before she died, I needed to write a book. I couldn't write a Christmas card. So I did it. I have it with me. If you're interested, it tells the story. It's not a sad book. There are parts of it that are sad, but it talks about hope and resiliency and loads of other signs that our loved ones are up there and they're helping us as much as they can. And that's important. I also did the Audible portion. This is my information. If I could ever help any of you at all, personally or professionally, that's my email. Sometimes it takes me a little while to get back to you, but I will help you in any way I can. You need to help each other and you need to be part of Sean and Eileen's mission. We would have had our 46th wedding anniversary on June 6th. And I'm now thinking I've lost Sean for 17 years where I haven't been able to physically hug him. But when I get up there, they're standing right here right now, just like you're not sitting there alone. And you just got to believe that you can carry that message forward. And I would sincerely appreciate if you did. Once again, I am so honored to be addressing this group because you have such a tremendous history. And people know about your conference across the country. And it's very humbling to be here. So thank you very much. God bless all of you.
Chief Kenny, thank you so much. Last year, we created a mental health awareness task force. We have people, Dave Lewis, past president, and also Sandy Gallion, who goes around the state teaching classes free. Dave Lewis does. It's okay to say I'm not okay. Sandy Gallion does classes on mental health awareness first aid. If any company department, please go on the MSFA website and use this for a company department drill. It's fantastic. Let's give Chief Kenny another round of applause.
Thank you very much, sir.
Hang on just a second. And I do that. And the photograph.
Thanks, everybody. God bless you. Thank you.